call to order the September 22nd, 2015 meeting of the Oshkosh Common Council. Welcome to everyone joining us today here in the council chamber, as well as those watching or listening through Oshkosh Community Media Services. We're happy to have citizens participate in their city government in any way, so welcome to all. I believe, Mr. Roloff, we have some new staff members to be introduced at this time.
Yes, we do. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. It's my pleasure to introduce somebody who's familiar to you, but now he's in a new role, our new Director of Public Works, James Robbie. James was previously our supervising engineer in charge of our stormwater program, so a lot of you know him from presentations on stormwater. I think Councilor Clark, because of his participation on that, knows James probably very well from many presentations, and you will all get to know him with that. But James has a great deal of experience with stormwater, but he's also worked across throughout the Department of Public Works, interacting with the different agencies on some regulatory issues, engineering type of issues, and then he's also worked with other departments in terms of the development process. So I think James will be a good addition to the management team, and happy to welcome here. Our second person is someone who you won't recognize because he's a brand new employee, and Mr. Davis is going to introduce our a new economic development technician.
Yes. Good evening. Josh Teagan, if you could stand up. He's our new employee in Economic Development Division. If you recall, Nancy Jo Dietzen had been working for the division. She had left us, and Mr. Teagan is replacing her, working in the real estate area for not only industrial and business parks, but also redevelopment sites and residential redevelopment. Also expect him to be leading our social media campaign in economic development, and we'll also be working on grants or additional grants. We'll be working in an economic development. So he's a new member of the team. He comes to us from UW Oshkosh, been living here for the last 5 years, and prior to that he'd been in similar type of capacity in a healthcare business in the private sector. So I'm sure you'll be seeing him on future projects.
And I would assume, Mr. Davis, that he'll be partnering with GoEDC, our public-private partnership that we founded and
Absolutely.
Are members of to drive economic development and bring business into Oshkosh.
Absolutely. Had one of those coordinating meetings today, went over the whole plan, everything's in perfect harmony.
Well, welcome.
Thank you.
Welcome. Thank you.
Thank you.
Would the city clerk please take the roll call?
Clark.
Here.
Allison Osby.
Here.
Herman.
Here.
Peck.
Here.
Piansky.
Here.
Stepanek.
Here.
Cummings.
Here.
Present 7.
Now we would have Councilmember Clark lead us in the invocation, and our students from Lourdes Academy, the Pledge of Allegiance.
We are mindful of the blessings of liberty that we have in this nation. May our decisions tonight improve the quality of life in our city and for our residents.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And I have a certificate for each of you. So if you want to come here and stand, face the camera that you can't really see back in the corner.
No, this is for you.
What would you like to, now that you're back in school and it's still summer, what, are you happy to be back at school? What's your favorite subject? Okay, good. Joelle, you're at Lourdes as well?
Yes.
What is your favorite subject now that you're back in school?
Right now I would have to be science.
Science? Okay, very good. Well, thank you. You can either stay and watch this exciting evening, or you can go home and study.
Well, that's
thank you. It is now time for citizen statements to the council. Citizens are to address the council only. Statements are limited to 5 minutes. Must address items that are not listed on the council meeting agenda, are limited to issues that have an impact on the city of Oshkosh, and the common council may address at a future meeting, and must not include endorsements of any candidates or other electioneering. I See a familiar face?
Bob Cornell, 548 Westmouth Avenue. I had to be here this evening to publicly compliment and Mr. Peck for his taking over the ball and running with it for the Fall Family Fun Fest. I had sent the email both to him and Steve Herman, and I think they drew straws and Tom lost. I agree with you, Tom, it is very difficult to say Fall Family Fun Fest, but you did a credible job. The only other comment I have is we both lived on West Smith for 20 years, and when you gave my address as Wisconsin, my wife got all nervous because she thought I never came home after that.
I stand corrected, Bob.
I'm sure.
You know, my one mistake all year, okay?
And you're forgiven.
Okay, all right.
It's not genuine.
However, it was a great day. I haven't got the final results yet. We got a board meeting next Monday where I'm sure everything will be by that time finalized, and we'll find out exactly how things went. For those of you that either participated or helped in any such way, it was great. I think one of the innovative things of this year was the staff decided to try something different. And they printed up tickets for grandparents, seeing as how it falls on Grandparents' Day, and that's the purpose of it. And my wife and I, as greeters, we had a great opportunity for 2 hours to greet all the grandparents. And I have to say that we were thanked so many times for something we had no part of except handing out the tickets. They were very grateful. And the tickets were to be redeemed for either a sandwich of a hot dog, a hamburger, or a brat. And I can admit, grandparents love to eat because we got rid of a lot of them. One other thing, I've noticed driving around the city, and I think Mr. Roloff had this on the city manager's report, but I think I missed part of it. There's a number of streets that are coming up with chevrons and a bicycle logo. I'm a little confused of what that all entails. My assumption was that it's the road has to be shared with vehicles and bicycles, and it's acknowledgement to drivers to be more aware. Correct. Is that correct?
Correct.
Yep. They're called sheros.
Sheros. Okay, very good. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Bob.
Dan Rylance, 602 East Parkway. I assume you weren't expecting Scott Walker tonight.
Oh, that went over really well. Guys are really stiff.
Good humor. Good humor.
Devalued by pictures with him.
Okay. I want to talk about the paving project on East Parkway. I've lived at 602 East Parkway since 1998, and our portion of that project is complete. Just want to share a few insights with you. Most of them are good. In fact, all of them are good. Public Works promoted this. They gave literature. They answered questions. We had sessions. They answered writing. So from a planning standpoint, it was absolutely excellent. There are a couple of really creative things. One is, I don't know whether you're driven by the block in front of the Head Start, but we have this incredible little, you know, what do they call them?
Speed bumps.
But you don't see it because it's part of the cement, and it just comes up gradually. But some people learn quickly that there is a speed bump there. Really creative. Never seen one like that before. We should have more of those. The dirt that was used on the terraces was top grade, much better than done on Monroe or a couple years ago over on Irving. Really good. And the hydro seeding went much better than the matting that you used a few years ago. The grass is up, looks green. It is green, it looks really nice. So from that standpoint, it's really nice. A couple other things with the sanitation people went out of their way to take the wheelies over, you know, holes and things for a couple weeks. So no homeowner had to actually try to find, you know, where the truck was or to get out. It was really well done. Bauer Construction Company gets an A. Incredible company. They were with us for many weeks because they did most of the work underneath. Paving people were good too, but Bauer's people were absolutely excellent. What a great company. We got to know a lot of them because they were there for forever. Your chief inspector, I don't know his name, but he's a star. He's there every morning at 6. He's there every evening at 8. Nice guy. You got your money's worth out of him. Really a cool guy. Okay, well, it was a good thing. I want just to throw a couple of ideas at you. One is, I made a sort of a calculation of the number of times Route 1 went on East Parkway from Monroe over to a couple blocks. And I came up with 28,000 times that bus went on our street. And I only calculated them going. I didn't calculate them returning because a few years ago you routed them on Monroe on the way back. But you know, that's more use on that street than probably all the vehicles that have been on there for all that time. Seems to me you ought to maybe make a little adjustment on that. That really takes the wear and tear on the streets. Okay, that's one item. Another item is the 6% financing for people who cannot afford to pay cash or cannot afford to get a home equity loan. That's really usury. It's just too much. The Catholic Church spoke against usury for over 1,000 years. If you read the Quran, it's prohibited in the Quran. So, you know, I'm sure you have fiscal reasons for that, but that 6% is way, way off the top. It ought to be lowered. And I'd really be interested to know a year from now how many people on my street had to go with that because they didn't have the money or they didn't have the home equity loan. Okay. Appleton last year passed a wheel tax. I have no idea what the cost-benefit ratios are of a wheel tax to finance streets, but I'd urge you to look at it and see what it's like. It is a new way to finance streets. I'd check it out. We could all learn from that. Just in conclusion, I've been there since 98. The street is fine. The people who did it did a really good job. And Mark Roloff is going to have a party over on my street when it's complete. Thank you.
Dan, I direct you to last week's budget workshop. Mr. Roloff did do a presentation on wheel tax.
I missed it.
That was rather, it was very informative, very detailed. And council is, we're not passing a wheel tax.
Sure.
We're not passing a wheel tax at this time, but it is something that is definitely on our radar.
Wonderful.
And I would urge you to pull up that particular.
I will. Can you give me a Reader's Digest condensation of what it was? I mean, what you came up with?
The options pursued by Appleton are probably not applicable to Oshkosh.
Okay.
And if we were going to do something, we want to do value-added, and maintenance seemed to be a real high feedback we got from the residents that maintenance was one thing, whether it's improving snow removal or patching of streets before they get the full treatment.
Yeah.
That's pretty much it, and if we were going to do it, focus on maintenance items that extend the lives of streets rather than just put it into the reconstruction of streets such as your street.
Okay. One last thing. Usually you put shrubs on the terraces after a paving project. I know our street terrace is only, you did it on Monroe, you did it on Irving.
Shrubs?
Not shrubs.
Or trees, little trees.
Trees. Oh, trees.
Trees, that's, I'm sorry. Yeah. Okay. There's none on East Parkway because I assume our terrace is too narrow. It's only 4 feet. But I'm thinking, wouldn't that have been neat if we would have put little shrubs, little bushes. 10 years from now, you drive down East Parkway, which would be a beautiful street with a little bit of greenery on each side. That's all. Thank you.
And I will let you know that the bump that Mr. Rylance refers to was an intentional bump. It wasn't just an imperfection in construction. And if Mr. Rylance is buying for the dedication party, I will absolutely be there.
Thank you. Mayor,
thank you.
Just a comment. We usually mark them, right? They may not be done with the signage on that section of the parkway, are they? Because all the other speed bumps are marked. So maybe there's a sign that didn't get put up yet.
We should put
because I know that in the Middle Village there's signage that because they're all over the Middle Village, yeah. And I know the one by the Payne has a sign. So I'm thinking that maybe it got missed, or maybe all the signage isn't up yet by the street department.
I think typically that kind of signage is going to be done by the transportation department.
Okay.
After the construction project as a whole is complete. There's typically also some pavement markings or paint that goes down that kind of gives another visual indication of where that speed hump is.
Okay. Yeah, I know they were going to put that in there because I remember meeting with a citizen about that, and it was for safety of Head Start and that. So I'm thinking if we don't have one assigned for that, we probably should, because that is now a pretty nice paved street, and speeds will be getting up there, even though the railroad tracks are right there, which is a launching pad. But thank you, Mayor.
Over to the consent agenda items. These are items of routine administrative nature that are voted on by the council in a single roll call vote. Staff recommends approval of all items. Any member of the public or common council may request that an item be removed from the consent agenda for discussion. 1, approval of bills presented by the finance director. 2, receipt and filing of common council minutes from September 8, 2015. Receipt and filing of museum board minutes from August 13, 2015. Receipt of claim filed with the city's insurance company, A, David Spire and Associates, on behalf of Cheryl Shettle for alleged injuries from falling on the sidewalk. B, Taylor Metzel for alleged damages to her vehicle from running over a bungee cord. Resolution 15-420, approved granting utility easement to Wisconsin Public Service Corporation, 200 North Campbell Road. Plan Commission recommends approval. Resolution 15-421, approved preliminary plat known as North Shore Estates 2 and plan development for a single-family residential subdivision, southeast corner of Riff Road and Edgewood Road. Plan Commission recommends approval. Resolution 15-422, approve engineering services agreement with CH2M Hill Engineers, Inc. for wastewater pretreatment program update, $103,000. Resolution 15-423, approve change order number 1 for public works contract number 15-21, an approved agreement for purchase of materials with Joseph Schmidt and Sons Construction Company, Inc. for the public works field operations facility, Phase 3, showing a negative $671,508.64. Resolution 424, support bill LRB 1921 to allow municipalities to sell liquor at wine and to sell liquor and wine at municipal parks and golf courses.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
I have a couple comments on 424. My name's Gary Gray, 815 West Linwood. When I was reading the information in the agenda packet, I was a little bit confused. Is this proposed bill allowing city staff to sell liquor and wine, or does it allow city to permit other people to sell liquor and wine in parks?
I can answer that, or Mr. Maurer can answer that.
Mr. Herman's been following this as well as Mr.
We'll let Mr. Maurer answer your question, Mr. Gray. I have the answer, but he'll do a much better job.
This bill would allow city staff of the municipality, county, city to sell the alcoholic beverages only, not to allow citizens that rent out our facilities.
I have a quick follow-up question. Is there any kind of city policy in regards to when this happens?
Because it's a bill that's looking to be introduced, we don't have a policy, but the only places that we currently sell alcohol or beer in the parks is at a city-operated leech function at various ones, at our REITs concession stands, as well as the Lakeshore Municipal Golf Course. And those have sale of beer at this time.
Resolutions 15-425 and Resolution 15-431 are special events for 2015, so we will start there. Resolution 15-425, Oshkosh West High School student government to utilize city streets for their Oshkosh West Homecoming Parade, October 2nd. Resolution 15-426, Oshkosh Festivals, Inc., to utilize Dockside Tavern, Riverwalk, and City Streets for their Oktoberfest, October 3rd. Resolution 15-427, Jeremy Gloat, utilize Riverwalk and City Streets for their Jeremy Monet Rock and Glow Fun Run Walk, October 16th. Resolution 15-428, UW Oshkosh to utilize City Streets, WeWash Trail, and Tribal Heritage Crossing for their UW Oshkosh Tour de Titan, October 17. Resolution 15-429, UW Oshkosh to utilize Oshkosh Sports Complex for the UW Oshkosh 10th City, October 17. Resolution 15-430, Downtown Rotary to utilize Opera House Square, Market Street, and High Avenue for their Oshkosh Chili Cook-Off, October 24. And Resolution 15-431, bid to utilize Opera House Square and City Streets for their Downtown Oshkosh Whoville Holiday, November 21. Resolution 15-432 is a special event for 2016 Special Olympics Wisconsin Fox Valley Region to utilize Menominee Park and City Streets for their Polar Plunge, February 19 and 20. Resolution 15-433, Do Try Run to utilize City Streets, Leach Amphitheater, and Riverwalk for their Oshkosh Marathon, Half Marathon, 5K, and Lionhearted Kids Run, April 23 and 24, 2016. Resolution 15-434, approval of block party Hayward Avenue between Norman Court and Wellington Drive, October 17, 2015. And Resolution 15-435, approve Class B fermented malt and Class C class wine license, Class A fermented malt license, special Class B licenses, operator licenses, and taxi cab driver licenses. Are there any questions on the consent agenda items from the public? Bring it back to council for a motion and a second.
Actually, can I ask a question, yes. Mr. Mayor? Resolution 15-423, I don't know if you could kind of elaborate a little bit on the change order here.
Well, I would encourage you to go to the memo itself. We only have half of the action here this evening. It's good news. It's a net savings of $20,504.68. We're only saving on the sales tax on the materials. We're not, the contractor's not providing the materials for free. But it's a, as you can see, it's a major purchase of $651,000, or excuse me, $651,000 without the tax. So what we'll bring back next week, because we didn't include the second half of the change order, was to add back the purchase of the materials from the company that's set to, so that we don't have to pay the taxes on it. But it's a great thing that we're saving $20,000, and that was something that we factored in when we were putting together the budget as we were moving forward with this project.
Thank you. That's all I had.
Okay. Looking for a motion and a second.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion?
Mayor. I have a couple questions. Mr. Burridge, if he's back there, I have a couple questions. Thank you. This is reference resolution 15-421, the approval of the preliminary plat. We've had trouble in the last couple of years of defaults in that area and developers not following through with their planned agreements. Sidewalk, I believe, streets didn't get completed, and then it went into bankruptcy. Do we have any assurances to our citizens that may be buying this and buying in that situation isn't going to happen again?
Yeah, I mean, we've changed our development agreement processes from when the one across the street to the west was developed. That was developed probably in the mid-2000s, maybe, at some point. And I don't think we have this. We have a different development agreement process set up, and it's generally handled by the folks in Public Works and the attorney's office. But things have changed since that, so we we have letters of credit, things like that.
So we have a little tighter
Correct.
Opportunity to know that this could be a successful project.
Correct.
And people that buy into these new subdivisions won't be left, because we've had numerous ones throughout the city. I think we had some out west of town, west of the city. A couple of development agreements didn't follow all the way through with certain things. And
The one in particular is the one to the west that I can recall,
right,
that we've had the issues with. The ones on the other side, I'm not sure about those.
Okay.
But this one has been the sticking point, one to the west of North Shore Preserve.
And we've had some discussion over the last couple of years of lack of single-family housing possibilities. Do they have a timeline on when they're going to get started on this, do you know?
I would assume they want to get into the ground next year, early next year.
Okay, very good. Thank you. And then I have one more, Mayor.
Yes.
It's follow-up on Resolution 15-424. I'd just like Mr. Maurer to go in a little more detail on the importance of us supporting this bill and what the added revenue could do to help the city.
Sure. The main reason we are looking for the council support in this bill is mainly for the Lakeshore Municipal Golf Course. As you're aware, there's very few municipalities that operate golf courses in the area. A lot of the golf courses operated in Wisconsin by municipalities are southern Wisconsin, southeastern Wisconsin. That's where a lot of this support is coming for this bill. The golf course is in a tough business right now to try to compete with a lot of other privately run golf courses. We try not to increase our fees too high, and we try to be fair with all the local golf courses so that we're not undercutting them. So I think we do a good job with our fee system. But we still are operating at deficits because it is set up in an enterprise fund, and there are certain things that are taken into account when dealing with the enterprise fund. So although it's been a good golf season this year, I think by having more golf outings is what would generate some additional revenue for the golf course. Our staff that we talk to out there really thinks we need to attract some more of the golf outings that tend to go to golf courses that have bars, that have the full capability to serve liquor and so forth. So I think it'd be a good revenue source opportunity for the golf course to help possibly improve the golf course in the long run, but also pay off some of the debt that they also owe the city as well.
Okay. And then in our support materials, there were two other organizations that supported it. That those are, you gave us support letters?
Yes. Both the League of Wisconsin Municipalities supports the resolution, as well as the Wisconsin Park and Rec Association. I think those were the two that I had. I don't know if I had a third one listed, but those are the main
That's
two.
That's it. All right. Thank you. That's all I have, Mayor.
Any further questions from council? I would ask the city clerk to take the roll.
Clark?
Aye.
Allison Osby?
Aye.
Herman?
Aye.
Peck?
Aye.
Pansky?
Aye.
Stepanek?
Aye.
Cummings?
Aye.
Carried 7.
We now have new ordinances, and there will be no formal action taken on the following two ordinances. The first is Ordinance 15-436, approve parking restrictions on Knapp Street and Wisconsin Street. Ordinance 15-437, approval of left turn regulations on Main Street and Merritt Avenue.
Bob Cornell, 548 West Smith Avenue. You are addressing one of my passions that goes back to the 2011-2012 situation when the left turn was added and no left turn was removed. I tried to go back and go through all the minutes of the traffic review board from them and also the council. And I do know Mr. Herman made a statement when it was voted to put the left turn in that he received no emails or nothing, but he knew I was against it because I had voiced that opinion. I still voice that opinion. I think it was a mistake, but that's 2-3 years ago, and we've had time to correct the mistake. I was glad to watch the traffic review board the other evening and see that the total, not total support, there was one dissenter, but the majority support of removing that left turn lane. The experience that I had, I spend enough time at the library, even though my Kindle keeps me in reading, but I don't want to pay $20 for a book, so when there's a new one, I go to the library and reserve it. And I learned that once that left turn was in, don't go down Merritt Street. Take Washington to Jackson and go back out to Oshkosh North High School. There was two occasions where I was seventh in line, which put me way back by Jefferson. I had to wait three lights because the first person always wanted to make a left turn and had to wait for the traffic coming from the west. That one would turn on basically red because they were out in the middle of the intersection. And the second one, going right or across, made sure they snuck through. But it took three light changes to even get up to Main Street in order to get across. So I'm hoping the support from the council is the same as the support from the traffic review, and we can get that thing removed, and I'll be happy to use Merritt Street again.
Okay. Thank you.
I'd like to speak on...
Your name and address, please.
Okay. Gary Gray, 815 West Linwood. I would like to speak on the ordinance 437. I've taken a look at the information that was in the packet, and the basic reason I saw in there is that people are a little bit inconvenienced because they have to wait for the turning of the street light. I have had experiences where I had to wait two or three signal light changes to get through the intersection, but I think if people want full and fast passes of intersections, they should have a special button on the car that would have a preempt signal that when they go to any intersection and they see a red light, they push the button so they can fly through the intersection. So I really don't see any great justification for this. I'm not saying don't do this or don't approve this. I'm just saying that what's the justification for removing this? The justification is removing traffic going south on Main Street from Merritt, thereby saying to the businesses on that block, hey, your customers have to go around the block a couple of times, go a couple of blocks away to get onto Main Street to park on Main Street. And I'm not sure if there's a justification. So I guess my concerns are the same as they were in June 10th, 2014, a year from June, when this issue was brought up again, or was brought up before. Thank you.
Mayor.
Mr. Collins, you've come forward. Would you like to say a few things?
Sure. I can. So the history of this is that left turn was restricted for, at least 20 years, up until probably more than that. I think it's about 25. But in 2002 in February, that restriction was taken out. At the time, the thinking was that it wasn't... the restriction wasn't needed. However, since then, I've got multiple requests to put this back in, and we haven't addressed it. I was asked to address it last year, but generally in our policy for department is that we need to wait 2 to 3 years before we'll relook at an issue. So it's been 3 years. When we had the construction on Mount Vernon this summer, we put a temporary restriction in because of the traffic flow down there, and it seemed to work well, and I got quite a few calls requesting that we put that back in again, specifically from the library and many residents in that area. And the main reason that it was voted to put it back in now, there are two reasons. Number one is that intersection has become much busier with the success of the businesses down there. Ski's Meat Market and the bike store have become busier than they were. So there's more traffic going through there, which leads to the delays. And when we looked at it about a year and a half ago, it wasn't too bad. But in the last year, it's gotten to the point where you do have to wait a couple cycles in order to get through that intersection, which leads to motorist frustration, which, although it hasn't led to accidents yet, I can sense I've been out there quite a few times and the frustration's growing, which could potentially lead to accidents. So that's the first reason, is because it's become busier. And then the second reason why the Traffic Review Board feels that this restriction should be put back in is there is a site restriction at that intersection. All the buildings are right up to the corner. So it is difficult to see when you're making a left-hand turn there, the oncoming traffic. So those are the main reasons that we're requesting it be put back in.
I didn't look at the minutes. I don't know if it was addressed in your traffic review advisory board meeting, but did you discuss a left turn only signal at that intersection?
Yes.
Okay.
Go ahead and explain why we can't do that.
Yeah, we can't do that there because the right-of-way is not wide enough to add an additional lane on the east side of Main Street on Merritt there. There's only room for one lane in each direction. Secondly, it's been suggested to look at the signal timing. That's something that we've looked at too. We can't do that because the signals on Main Street are coordinated so that you can make them through in a reasonable amount of time. If we adjusted the timing on the signals at Merritt, that it will mess up the coordination of the signals on Main Street. So we looked at a number of different alternatives, and that's what the board felt that it was justified to put this restriction back in. I honestly haven't got any calls that say that that restriction should not be there. I have gotten numerous calls that we should have never taken that restriction out. But the main reason that I think that the board has recommended putting this back in is due to how busy that intersection has become once again.
Any further questions for Mr. Collins?
And then I can answer you on that on the speed bump too. Mr. Robbie's correct. We just haven't. They just finished that reconstruction, so we generally paint the white chevrons on there, and then we'll get to the signage too.
I figured that.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, we're at council discussion, direction of the city manager, and future agenda items. Future agenda items would be the budget workshops.
We have them planned for Tuesday and Wednesday, October 20th and 21st all day, and then the CIP workshop we've typically held as our third budget work session. That would be November 4th at 5 p.m. We are scheduling all the departments in for the first 2 days, but I know that I've gotten feedback from council members in the past that they wanted to spend some more time on CIPs. It'll be an all-night event or an all-evening event. If there's any other thoughts you have about how you want to address CIPs, certainly open to them. If we're done at the conclusion of the daytime, we could do some of the CIPs on those days. If you have a preference, we do have a few weeks before we have to make a decision about that, but I know that I've heard from several of you that you don't feel that you're getting enough discussion about the capital improvements, and it's a big dollar amount, and I think you feel a little uneasy about just passing a $50 million plan without at least having a good discussion on some of the pros and cons of it. So anxious for any input you may have on that.
Mayor? Yeah, it's a change. Several council members have talked to some city staff personnel, and they're real excited about having it during the day versus in the evening. But if we do get done, I think on the ahead of time on the 21st, we could obviously start discussion. We should probably know by the end of the first day how many departments are left for the second day and where we would be at. But even if it was just kind of general overview of some of the major projects or things that are in the CAP, and then a more lengthy discussion or workshop on the 4th would be good too. But I agree. My 5 years on council, I think sometimes the CIP comes at the 13th hour, and maybe it should actually be the first hour, and because it is a big ticket item. So I would support it.
Thank you.
Either way.
I think most of the council prefer doing it this way we're doing during the day. Then at night, everyone's worked a full day, and you're not on your best game.
It's really more about how we get the CIP in there for you. So we'll try to squeeze in as much as we can with in the full days that we do have. And so we'll plan accordingly.
Okay. And I'll bring pizza to one of those.
You're such a in writing.
In writing.
10 minutes.
Would you like it in a box?
Sure.
All right. So let me know which day. It doesn't have to be pizza. We're at the next citizen statements to council. Citizens are to address the council only. Statements are limited to 5 minutes. Must address items that are not listed in the council meeting agenda, are limited to issues that have an impact on the city of Oshkosh, and the common council may address at a future meeting, and must not include endorsements of any candidates or other electioneering.
Good evening again. Gary Gray, 815 West Linwood. I want to make a few comments in regards, I hope it's permissible, in regards to the process of the CIP. The comment I wanted to make is that the five-year CIP program does not have to be connected to the budget. It can be done basically any time if you consider the five-year CIP plan as a planning document, not a budget document. And the way that would work is that the 5 years would be reviewed, or two years, three years, whatever. And then in November, the council would approve what's called a capital budget, which would be for the upcoming year. So in this case, it would be approving the capital budget for 2016. Thank you.
Anyone else from the public that would like to say anything? We're at the council member announcements and statements. Ms. Pansky, you wanted to, looking for a report on the mayor's breakfast.
Yes, thank you, Mayor. Actually, at the South Park Farmers Market, I've been asked a couple of times. It seems every time I go there, I get asked about an update on the mayor's breakfast, so I'll refer to Mr. Roloff for the actual update. But
thank you, Councilor Pansky. Trish Marks, who is a city employee but is a volunteer for this, since I know where she works, I asked her to give some information. First of all, she and several other people, including the mayor, but Rick Vanderloop with Festival Foods, Jody Jensma with the Oshkosh Convention Visitors Bureau, as well as Trish, have been big parts of maintaining the mayor's breakfast for a number of years. As the connection with EAA started to fade off, they brainstormed on some ideas and wanted to have it more of a community-oriented event, and so they moved it to coincide with the Gus Macker tournament and the farmers market, and they admittedly recognized it had mixed results. But when you think about the EAA folks who are no longer there, the numbers show that there's still some good support for it. I think the committee has to decide, because it's not a city function, but it's certainly something of great interest to everybody. From 2012 to 2014, the attendance was somewhere between 579 and 686, so 600 to 700 people. This year it was 389, so it was below 400, but the drop-off could be attributed to mainly EAA attendees. Most of those attendees were the folks that stay at the university and make their way down Algoman High to come to the breakfast. So we still had close to 400 people at the event this year, and it sounds like they're planning to do it again next year. I'm not sure how they're planning to mix it up again. That the mayor may have insight onto it, but according to the memo I received from Trish, she felt that they still needed to do a debriefing on it,
right?
And I don't think they've gotten to that point yet.
You're correct. We have not done a debriefing.
But I think people were curious to know whether or not the numbers were in fact lower than they had been in previous years, and that answers the question. So
again, talking to Trish and Jody, they wanted to make it even more family, community oriented. That's why this year we had the bouncy house and some face painting.
Just, I helped out there too, and I thought it was a really good event, and yeah, the numbers might have been lower, but I still think that this is a great opportunity. The mayor's breakfast should be a showcase of Oshkosh. It should be a citizen's breakfast. And so I think that through promotion, through our neighborhood associations, through some other opportunities, maybe some banners down up and down Main Street, through the bid, through the Rotary Clubs, the Lions Clubs, the Kiwanis Clubs, all those organizations getting the information out could increase the attendance. And yeah, I'm sure that some people are concerned with the Gus Macker tournament. Parking might be an issue, but the breakfast was in front of that. But at the same time, I think it's a great event, and I'd like to see it separate, because this is no knock to EAA, obviously, but they have worked very hard to keep events and activities at EAA for their members. And in the 5 years I've been involved at the Mayor's Breakfast, the numbers keep going down of EAA participants. And so I think this is a great opportunity for us, even though it's not, the city function per se. It's a great opportunity to promote the city of Oshkosh, promote the Leach Amphitheater. A lot of people may have never been there, and this is an opportunity to get there and make it family-friendly is obviously the way to go. And so I think first year, we can improve on it the second, third, and fourth year.
And I think because of the change, there were probably, this is hard to quantify, there were probably a lot more citizens of Oshkosh there because they felt it was more of their community breakfast. So. But we're open to all suggestions to make it even bigger and better event in 2016. Speaking of family events, city manager announcements and statements. The first is trick or treating.
Well, you can guess what date it's going to be, but it's going to be October 31st. When it's on a weekend, we typically extend the hours from 4 to 7. We start earlier is pretty much what we do. So October 31st, 4 to 7 p.m. The other item I have for you, there's a memo in your agenda packet. We're going to be engaging Schenck Associates to conduct our audit again. We're in the process of switching over our software. We feel keeping that continuity, it would be important for the time being. I think it's important to go out every few years and get a proposal, but this isn't the right time. We'll do it after the software is up to date. They're very familiar with the lovely imperfections in our accounting system, and once we get through that, I think we can take a look at bidding that out. Update on employee health insurance. Originally, I indicated we were going to have the contract for you to approve at this meeting. We didn't have quite everything done yet, and I just didn't want to throw it in front of you sight unseen and say approve it, so we're spending a little more time on it. The most important thing is that we have a 90-day cancellation notice for our current contract, and I'm doing that right now, so there's a little bit of an open area, but we're actively working on the contract with the county's association, so I don't have any concern that we don't have the contract in place, even though we're sending the cancellation notice. So at a future meeting, there's 3 weeks between this meeting and the next meeting, so we'll be getting it to you very shortly. And then lastly, a little bit of a commercial announcement. Stone of Hope exhibit is going to be at First Congregational Church. There's a fifth Tuesday, so fifth Tuesdays are wonderful because I get to go do things I like to do. This is one of them. It's really talking about the history of African Americans in the Fox Valley, and I think it's a fantastic exhibit, and it's very eye-opening for the community to see a little bit of history that they may not be familiar with. Again, it's First Congregational Church right here on Algoma Boulevard. It'll be at 7 p.m. on next Tuesday, September 29th.
Okay, thank you. Deputy Mayor Peck, you have a motion to make.
I would move to go into closed session. Council may convene into closed session pursuant to Section 19.85, Parent 1, Parent G, to confer with legal counsel who will give legal advice concerning strategy to be adopted with respect to litigation in which the city is involved pertaining to property located at 1118 South Main Street, Parent, the former Buckstaff property, and Parent.
There a second?
Second.
Take the roll, please.
Clark?
Aye.
Allison Osby?
Aye.
Herman?
Aye.
Pep?
Aye.
Hansky?
Aye.
Stefanik?
Aye.
Cummings?
Aye.
Carried 7.
I look for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Adjourn. Let's go.